Good morning. Welcome to our service today. Am I on? You can hear me? Well, delighted to see all of you today. What a great day it is to be in God's house. Now, this morning I started walking down and I told everybody to stand up and get out of their pew and go welcome somebody. And they went on for about 10 minutes. And I figured if I did that in this service, we'd go on for an hour and have to do the benediction and go home. But I do want you to stand up just for a moment. Right now. And not the one you're standing beside, but maybe two or three people away from you. Just welcome them today. Would you do that? Good morning. Yeah. Good morning. Good to see you. There you go. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord.
Thank you. Let us unite together in the opening prayer. You will find it printed in your bulletin. All week, we have been fighting the good fight, running the race, and keeping the faith. And today, we need your care, for we must go out and strive again next week. Silence the tumult in our lives. Lift us from all sins and defeat. Pour your Spirit upon us. Water the furrows of our lives with your softening showers. We wait in the goodness of your house for your merciful and generous care. Amen. Let us continue with a moment of personal prayer. God, I ask you to hear the prayers of your people. And when you answer, may we be careful to say thanks. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. This past week, did you have any moments of doubt? Did your faith waver? Did you ask, God, where are you? How long will you wait? If so, will you strengthen your faith with me as we unite in the Apostles' Creed? Please stand. Together we confess. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us be seated as we pray together. God, give us your strength. God, give us your wisdom. God, give us the strength and wisdom so that this week we might live as we ought to live. For surely, Lord, we'll need that strength to conquer the temptations which will come to us. Otherwise, God will be tempted and will forget our morals. Without your strength, we'll be tempted and we will shirk some of our responsibilities. We'll forego portions of your commandments. So as we are tempted, God, give us the strength to do every task assigned to us and somehow make it possible for us to do your work with a smile. And as your Spirit strengthens us, give us your wisdom and well, so that in all we do, God, we'll know the right path to take, so that wisdom will know us when to speak and when to keep silent. Out of your wisdom, we'll know when to act and when to refrain from action. With your wisdom, we'll know when to speak our mind and when to hold our peace. God, give us this strength. God, give us this wisdom so that we'll come to the end of our week content, knowing that we pleased you with our lives in some small way. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen. Next Sunday is a very wonderful worship service and one that we are looking forward to. It is the blessing of the backpacks. Boys and girls, it is that favorite time of the year when you get to go back to school, and for parents, it's like Christmas morning. But before you head off back to school, we want to show our love, our nurture, and our blessings. We want you to come invite all of your friends, everyone that you know, for this very special service that is directed just for you. Also today at 3:15 is a call church council meeting. This is so that the church council can make preparations for our charge conference At 4 o'clock, which involves the buying of the Olahip property right here next to our church, we want to invite all of you to come and to participate and hear the presentation, ask questions, whatever may be happening. That is at 4 o'clock today. It is also the very first charge conference presided by our new district superintendent, and I want to invite all of you to come out and to meet Frederick Yeboah. Frederick Yeboah is an African. He was born in Ghana, and now he has served the Methodist Church in South Carolina for 30 years. So come out for both of those reasons today. At this time, we invite the ushers to come forward to receive your tithes and your offerings. And as they come, we ask that everyone remember the ritual of friendship pad. Register your presence, your attendance, and also if you might have any ministry concerns.
Thank you.
During the singing of the next hymn, we invite the children to follow the crucifer to children's worship. Please remain standing as we read the Gospel. Luke, the 18th chapter, verses 9 through 14. He told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and regarded others with contempt. Two men went up to the temple to pray. One a Pharisee, another a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, was praising thus, "God, I thank you that I am not like other people." Well, it didn't sound like a prayer to me. It sounded more like a bragging session. Thieves, rogues, adulteries, or even like this tax collector, "I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all my income. Oh, Lord, just look at how good I am." But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even look up to heaven, but was beating his breast and saying, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." I tell you, this man went down to his home justified rather than the other, for he who exalts himself will be humbled, and all who humble themselves will be exalted. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. I want to thank Lisa and Lauren today. Lauren has spent the summer in Italy singing and performing, and her voice is better than ever. Thank you, Lauren. To say that the Pharisees disliked Jesus was an understatement. They despised Jesus. They saw every way they could to entrap him and to discredit him, much like the politicians today. You know, politicians no longer run on their own record. They run on how awful and how bad their opponent is. And so they run this very negative campaign. And once you watch one of these negative ads, by the time you figure out that it's not true, they've already put on 10 more. So that by the time we enter into the election booth, we're holding our nose, trying to decide which one we're going to vote for, which is the lesser of two evils. You see, the Pharisees ran throughout all the Gospel of Luke this negative campaign trying to discredit Jesus. And I'm going to tell you how it turned out. Go home today, read the Gospel of Luke, and look at this battle between Pharisees and Jesus. For a time, the Pharisees looked like they were in control. It looked like they were winning and that Jesus was done. But folks, love wins every time. And that is the case in the gospel lesson. The Pharisees despised Jesus. Why? Well, there was two very different philosophies. The Pharisees believed that the way to heaven and the way to God was by being good. I know people like that today, don't you? That the way to get to heaven, the way to be saved, the way of salvation is by being good. And the way to be good is by following the rules that God laid down for all of us. Now, for the Pharisee, it was not enough just to follow the rules. They had to do more. It was Ten Commandments plus. It was, okay, I'm going to do more than what is required, more than the law, more than the rules, because that will make me better in the eyes of God. And so among all the Pharisees, there was this competition among themselves about who was better. And along comes Jesus. Jesus, who didn't despise the sinner, but loved the sinner. Jesus, who didn't reject the sinner, but accepted the sinner. One of the ways for a Pharisee to be better was not only to be sinless, and listen, Pharisees were fairly sinless, a lot more than you or me. It was not enough to be sinless. They would not even associate with anyone who had sinned. And so they banished the sinner. They disassociated themselves from the sinner. And by the time Jesus came along, there was no room for the sinner. There was no room for the sinner in the religious life, in the temple or in the synagogue. There was no mercy. There was no grace. And the only thing that was left was a handful of self-righteous people. Jesus came along loving sinners. No wonder the Pharisees were threatened by Jesus. Because there were so few Pharisees, and Lord, there were so many sinners. They followed Jesus because he accepted them. He loved them. He forgave them, and his love and forgiveness turned their life completely around. And so Jesus loved sinners. One day, Jesus went into the house of a Pharisee. The Pharisee had invited him to eat with him, And when he sat down at the table, this woman from the city walked in. Now, her reputation was well known. She was a great sinner, and everyone in that town knew it. But when she heard that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she came in and sat down behind him. And then she started to wash his feet with her tears. And she dried his feet with her hair. And then she started to kiss his feet. And then she anointed him with beautiful perfume. Now, when the Pharisees saw what this sinner, this woman, had done, he said to himself, if Jesus were a prophet, he would have known who it was that was touching him and acting in such an inappropriate way and would not have allowed it. And so, Jesus said to the Pharisee, you know, there was a creditor. And there were two men who owed him money. One owed him $5 and another owed him $500. Well, that's not what the scripture said, but there was a big gap. Now, it came time to pay, and neither one of them had the money. And so the creditor forgave them both the debt. And Jesus said to this Pharisee, which one of these two men loved that man the most? And the Pharisee answered, why, the one who was forgiven the most. And Jesus said, you're right. From the time I walked into this house, you gave me no water to wash my feet. This woman has done nothing but to wash my feet with her tears since I've been in this house. You didn't greet me with a kiss. She hasn't stopped kissing my feet and anointing me with sweet perfume. This woman loved so much because she was forgiven much. And you, Pharisee, I think that's the way Jesus did it. You, Pharisee, you have a small heart. Because you've been forgiven little. And the person that's been forgiven little loves little. And then he looked at this woman and Jesus said, your sins are forgiven you. Acceptance? Love? No wonder the Pharisee despised Jesus. And so he told this story. He told this story of two men who went up to the temple to pray. One man prayed to himself. He didn't pray to God. It really wasn't a prayer. It was a bragging session. He said, Lord, I thank you that I am not like other people. And then he started naming the other people. He looked around in the synagogue and he started pointing them out. Lord, I thank you that I'm not like thieves or rogues or adulterers or even like this tax collector way at the back of the church. Now here's the sin of the Pharisee. It is so bold, it is so loud, it was right in front of his face, and he didn't see it. It was the sin of conceit. He thought he was better than other people. Usain Bolt just won the 100 meters and the 200 meters in the Olympics. This is the second time in two Olympics that he's won both of those. And when he won them for the second time, he stood up and said, I'm the greatest athlete in the world. I'm the fastest man who has ever lived in the entire world. No one is greater than me. We don't like arrogance, do we? Well, he was right. He broke an Olympic record. He broke a world's record. He is no doubt the fastest man who ever lived. But I don't care how fast Bolt is, he's not any better than you or me. In King Street, this young woman was attending my church. and she was married to this African American. He didn't attend King Street United Methodist Church. He was a Baptist, and he attended the church down the street. But they were married, and soon they had a child. And one day she came to me and said, "I want my child to be baptized." I said, "Sure, bring them." And so on the day of the baptism, there this young mother stood with her husband and her baby. I took this child, like I take every child. I asked the parents the vows of baptism. I asked the church, "Will you love and will you nurture this child?" I paraded that child up and down the aisle. I can't tell you the letters I received the next week. You see, living in King Street 18 years ago was like living in the 1950s. I can't believe that black man stood up in our church like he owned the place. And then they started criticizing the woman. What kind of woman is she? And then they started criticizing the child. A mixed breed. Why, no one is going to love and accept this child because of their parents' selfishness. And they just vowed to love and to care for that child. I addressed as many of them as I could, and I said to them, all of those critics, I said to them, that child didn't choose her parents. She had no choice in that. That child is innocent. That child is a beautiful creation of God. And so are their parents. And so are you. I didn't convince all of those critics. But you know, there were a lot of people in our church who believed the same way I did, in the midst of a lot of hatred. You see, when you start thinking that you are better than anyone else, and your hatred and your arrogance and your conceit gets the best of you, you're in for a great fall. The first sin of the Pharisee was that he thought he was better than everyone else. I've known people like that, haven't you? And then he prayed, "Lord, I thank you that I'm not like other people. I tithe twice a week. I tithe of everything that I have. I fast twice a week." And he was telling God how good he was. How great he was. Now let me tell you, folks. I don't care how many times you come to church on Sunday morning. I don't care how many times you fast or pray. I don't care how much you give. Well, yeah, I do. But I'm going to tell you this. None of that will get you into heaven. None of that will get you in heaven. Jesus told a story. Or he was in the house of church one day, and he was teaching, and this woman came up to him, and she had been crippled for 18 years. 18 years. And there on the Sabbath, he stood up and he said, "Woman, you are healed." And she was cured of being crippled, and she stood up straight. 18 years she had been crippled over. And the Pharisee stood up and said, "Jesus, why do you heal on the seventh day? Why? Isn't there 6 days in the week you're supposed to work? Couldn't she have come Monday through Saturday or Sunday through Friday in the Jewish religion? Couldn't she have come and be healed then?" And then Jesus said to the Pharisees,
the ones who wanted to keep the rules, the one who wanted to be good, he said, "How many of you in this synagogue untie your oxen on the Sabbath to lead them to water to drink?" They all raised their hand. And Jesus answered and said, "How much more should this woman who has been bound by the devil for 18 years be set free? After all, she is a daughter of Abraham. You Pharisees, you care more about animals, you care more about the rules than you do people." Folks, being good won't get you to heaven. And then there was the tax collector at the back of the church. He wouldn't even lift up his head. Usually you lift up your hands and your head and you pray to God. That's the way the Pharisee prayed in front of everyone. He wouldn't even lift up his head. He started beating on his chest and he prayed, "Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner." We aren't going to get to heaven on our goodness. Only on the mercy of God. Back in King Street again, one of my minister friends got in trouble. Big trouble. He stole from the church. Not a little bit, a lot. He stole God's money. Now, I don't have a lot of empathy for preachers who do such a thing, because they have a reflection on all of us, sort of like Jim Baker years ago. But this man was my friend. He was my friend. He was facing a lot of years of prison time. Not only had he made a mistake, his cover-up was worse than his mistake. And on the day of his trial, I drove over 100 miles to be there, to stand up and to speak for him. When I was talking to the judge, I said, "Your Honor, I'm not standing before you because my friend is innocent. He's not. I'm not standing before you because he is good. He's not. I'm standing before you because he's my friend. Have mercy." And then that judge stopped me right in the middle of my talk. He loved guilty. He loved he's not innocent. He loved he's not good. But the moment that I started talking about mercy, he stopped me. And he said, "Preacher, what church are you from again?" I said, "King Street United Methodist Church." "Oh, yeah, I know that congregation. 100 miles away, this judge knew the church I was serving. It was the hometown church of my friend." And he said, "I just have one question for you. What would Miss Librand think about your friend?" "Did you know Miss Librand?" "No, sir, I didn't. She passed away before I came to King Street. But I heard all the stories about her. You see, Miss Librand was a retired missionary. She grew up in King Street, was a single person all of her life, served as mission, came back and retired in King Street. And this is how she would come into church every Sunday morning. She'd come in the back door, walk way around where everyone could see her, and she came to her pew. And she sat down. And everyone knew not to sit in her place on her pew. A visitor made that mistake one time, and it never happened again. But when she sat down, she threw her arm across the pew, looked below her glasses, and she gazed at everyone in the congregation, taking a mental note of who was there and who was not there, and they would catch it during the next week. Everybody in that church was afraid of Miss Librand. They were afraid of her standards. They were afraid of what she might think. They were afraid of what she'd say. And the judge stood up there and said, "What does Miss Librand think about your friend?" And I said, "Your Honor, I really don't know. I think she would have been disappointed. I think she would have been hurt. And I know for certain she would not have approved. But this much I know. She loved my friend. He grew up with her. She loved him. Your Honor, have mercy." He did. He extended mercy. More mercy than my friend deserved. And after the trial was over, he started blaming everybody, the district superintendent, the church, the congregation that he was serving and he was working with. He just blamed everyone else but himself. Folks, it takes a while sometime for mercy to plant its seed and to work. He called me about 10 years later, right out of the blue. And he said, "George, I never thanked you. I never thanked you for everything you did for me. And until now, I never understood what it took for you to stand up there on my behalf. I'm going to counseling now. And I'm dealing with all the demons deep down inside of me. Thank you." Sometimes it takes a while for mercy to work. Folks, I look out at this congregation and I see a bunch of sinners. I know. I know you. I also see some Pharisees. In fact, sometimes I think we're both. I think sometimes there is a huge battle going between us. When we commit the sin, we're the sinner wanting mercy. When someone else commits the sin, then we're the Pharisee. There's this huge battle going on inside of all of us. Folks, when I look out, I see a bunch of sinners. I want St. John's to be known as the place where no sinner is ever turned away. That in this place they will be loved and accepted. That kind of love will change this church. That kind of love and acceptance and forgiveness will change Aiken. That kind of love will change the world. Two men went up to pray. One of them said, "Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner." For you see, there's a bunch of sinners out there in the world, too. And they need to know the love and the mercy and the grace of God. Two men went up to the temple to pray. One of them left justified. One of them left feeling the mercy and the love of God. Let us leave church the same way today.
There's not a person in this congregation that Jesus doesn't love. There's not a person in this congregation that His love and His mercy is not extended to. I don't want to feel like I'm better than anyone else, do you? Because we're all in the needs of God's mercy. And today I pray that God's mercy, God's love, God's grace will fill your heart. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.